these are all interrelated. Science, engineering, and technology is actually a complete, a close loop, circle, or a triad in which they complement each other. And at the centroid of this triangle sits the society.
Hi, welcome to the Laboratory for Biomaterials, IIT Kanpur. But our laboratory is one of the most important interdisciplinary laboratory in this institute as well as in the country.
And the strength of each individual member is the entire team. To our guide,
our philosopher,
our greatest source of inspiration,
also a friend, Dr. Balani.
This lab was renamed as Laboratory for Biomaterials in 2005 by Professor Bikramjit Basu.
We all know that journey of 1,000 miles begins with a small step.
When I will place a water which is dyed with the methyl orange on this uncoated substrate, now you can see it will penetrate through the mesh and spread all over the substrate. Whereas the coated SEF substrate shows the excellent repulsion of the water droplet.
The importance of wettability of biomaterials. This is contact angle machine.
Don't worry, travelogy is not a word from another planet. Travelogy is basically the science of friction when two bodies are in articulating motion. Wettability of material plays an important role in biological, travelogical, and thermal properties.
For which we prepared an electrolytic cell which contains an anode and a cathode. And the electrolyte, which is made of the salts of desired metal, which we want to plate from the anode to the cathode.
We have with us Mr. Fahad Alam, a PhD student, to present his work.
So today I'm going to present a seminar on the bacterial associated infection of biomaterial. So these are the different, you can see the images of the infection at the different part of the human body.
It's 4 o'clock in the evening and the India's cheapest cafe coffee day is calling us for a party. Hi, welcome to the Laboratory for Biomaterials, IIT Kanpur. I am Arjav Bhattacharya, a first-year postgraduate student in the Department of Material Science and Engineering, IIT Kanpur. I am also a member of this group. Perhaps you are thinking, as our name is Laboratory for Biomaterials, so we work only in the field of biomaterials. But our laboratory is one of the most important interdisciplinary laboratory in this institute as well as in the country. Now I will take you to a watchful tour of our laboratory. Perhaps you are thinking, what is actually meant by material science and engineering? Is it a science? Is it a technology? Or is it a bridge between science, technology and medicine? First, we'll clear our concept about material science and engineering, then we'll move on to the watchful tour of our group.
See, science is a fundamental question of asking no why. Why does a natural phenomenon occur in a given way and not another way? When we ask the simple question as to why some material is very much conducting, why some others are completely insulating, we are only looking at the fundamental aspect as to why the behavior is in a given pattern. When we make use of them in limited fashion and start applying them for certain gainful purpose, then we move into engineering. So that is know-how. How do we translate the fundamental knowledge into application? But that's not enough for the ultimate knowledge to translate into a viable product or a technology. So technology is another step forward and the last mile. When these initial exploitations reach the common man and proves to be a technology which is selling in the market, viable, and viable not only in terms of economy but in terms of energy consumption, material recycling, ethical issues, safety issues, and various other things. But then these are all interrelated. Science, engineering, and technology is actually a complete, a closed loop circle or a triad in which they complement each other. And at the centroid of this triangle sits the society. And the society keeps on demanding better and better performance. Now, talking about engineering materials and engineering applications, all the applications, particularly the ones which relate to some hardware, will eventually depend primarily upon the performance of certain key materials. And we all would like to improve the performance of those key materials. It could be a metal or a ceramic or a polymer or combinations of them in hybrid or composite form. In order to enhance the performance and make it reliable and make it viable for a particular application, one needs to form a very good understanding or a correlation among three things. One is the structure, the other one is the property that we are interested in, and the third leg is the process parameters through which these materials are fabricated or the components are fabricated. So this is typically called the physical metallurgy approach, where you try to understand or create a structure property correlation and in turn with the process parameter. So structure property process parameter correlation is the key of material science and engineering. Earlier we used to refer only to metal, so we used to call it metallurgical approach. Now we consider all possible engineering materials, we bring them into the same consideration. So polymers, ceramics, all put together. So the situation, the reach has now increased, so we call it material science and engineering. So that's the overall approach.
Hi, I'm Aditi.
I'm Shikha.
I'm Rita.
And I'm Shruti.
Okay, so far we have learned about various aspects of material science and engineering. Now, let us travel the journey towards the wonderland of our research group. The major motto of our research group lies on the words of a very famous philosopher, Phil Jackson, which is, the strength of the entire team is each individual member, and the strength of each individual member is the entire team.
So don't you worry who is the guiding light or the guiding source behind our team spirit or the teamwork. It is our guide, Dr. Kantesh Balani. We are all very grateful to have a guide like him. So now I introduce you to our guide,
our philosopher,
our greatest source of inspiration,
also a friend, Dr. Balani.
Welcome to the Laboratory for Biomaterials. Initially, this lab was founded as Laboratory for Advanced Ceramics by late Professor V.S.R. Murthy in the late 1990s. And later on, when we realized that the work is also towards more for biomedical materials, this lab was renamed as Laboratory for Biomaterials in 2005 by Professor Bikramjit Basu. And now this lab has taken a pivotal role, especially in multi-institutional international projects like Indo-US Science and Technology Forum, and also with UK Education Research Initiative. So this lab had been doing pretty good, or I think as far as international standards are concerned, and we are also translating our research to something which is more tangible. This lab has research focuses on a variety of areas, starting from, say, biomaterials. So in biomaterials, we work a lot on polymeric-based biomaterials as well as on ceramic-based biomaterials. And regarding this polymeric-based biomaterials, we work mainly on the acetabular cup liner for the hip joints. And therein we play a lot with terms of dictating or deciding the multifunctionality that can be attained in polymeric these liners. And we utilize zinc oxide, silver reinforcements to assess their not only biological properties but also tribological properties while attaining some multifunctionality. So that way we can enhance their wear life of this acetabular cup liner. So when the life is usually 5 to 6 years, that can be extended to as high as around 10 to 15 to 20 years with these reinforcements. Secondly, we also work on utilizing ceramic particles for bone implants. And in that case, we try to utilize functionally gradient materials. So on the surface of biomaterial, we require good, a very good bioactivity, whereas the core component of it should have a very, very good fracture toughness. And if you just put them together, the bioactive surface with the very, very tough core layer, they will delaminate without any hesitation. So we also need to provide a cushioning layer in between. So that way we have to develop something called as a functionally gradient material to attain high surface activity, bioactivity, with a cushioning or intermediate layer which can serve as a transition to provide the toughness. And once we talk about biomaterials, it is very essential that we quantify what is the interaction of the biological cells with the biomaterial that is inserted into the body of a particular person. So for that, we actually take AFM and then we also try to put that particular cell on a cantilever tip and try to quantify the adhesion strength of that particular bacteria or cell on a biomaterial surface. So that way we can learn or understand how these cells interact with the surface and be able to categorize which biomaterial will be providing enhanced anchoring to the biological cells. And apart from these biological materials, we also work a lot on ultra high temperature ceramics. And when we talk about ultra high temperature ceramic, we are talking about temperatures to the tune of more than 2400 degrees centigrade. And these materials need to have at least that much of a melting point, and they should be able to sustain these temperatures for at least few minutes. And that's where we can utilize these particular materials for the re-entry space vehicles. And in this group, we work on tantalum carbide, zirconium diboride and hafnium diboride based ultra temperature ceramics. And to assess the performance, relative performance of ultra temperature ceramics, it's very important that they are acclimatized to the similar condition what they will experience once they are coming back to the earth. So the re-entry part has to be mimicked on earth, and that's very, very tricky. And that's why they are exposed to plasma temperature which are more than around 10,000 Kelvin or so for a duration of 30 seconds to 1 minute with a very, very high plasma flux. And the oxidation behavior actually is quantified based on how they perform in the plasma jet exposure. They are now rated based on what is their relative damage on the surface as well as what is the extent of oxidation that has occurred in these particular materials. And third component is on magnesium lithium based ultra light aerospace materials. And in that case, we were very much interested in replacing some structural components of aircraft utilizing this low temperature, low density material. And these are one of the lightest materials that one can think of. But the major problem with them is their coarsening, the grain coarsening, which ultimately leads to the reduced strength. So if you just keep them in the room temperature, they will tend to, basically the precipitates will tend to coarsen, and the hardness part, the strength part actually deteriorates with time. And also they are highly prone to corrosion. So we also need to think on strategies to prevent surface corrosion by coating them with appropriate materials. So that is the overall paradigm of our major thrust that we are envisaging. One is on biomaterials, both polymeric as well as ceramic based materials. So we are looking into translating it into actual real life component, especially polymer for acetabular cup liner and ceramic materials for utilizing them as a porous scaffold so that the bone regrowth can occur in patients at a very, very faster rate. And second component is on ultra high temperature ceramic. So that we are working with Vikram Sarabhai Space Center and to basically mimic or to prepare a prototype of these nose cones, which have a very, very small radii in terms of when they are re-entering the Earth atmosphere. And it is also very important that we are able to control or minimize that radius of curvature, because the finer the radius of curvature, then we should be able to control the direction of that particular aircraft. And that makes it very, very difficult, because now a smaller area will be getting exposed. And that is the thrust this lab will have in the next coming years. And final aspect is again on the magnesium lithium based material, again for the structural application, while controlling their corrosion as well as their strength reduction that generally usually happens in these particular alloys. So with that, I welcome you again to the Laboratory for Biomaterials. Thanks.
We all know that journey of 1,000 miles begins with a small step. Similar thing can be applied for the processing of materials also. For processing of materials, the first step is compaction. And for compaction, we have compaction molding, we have spark plasma sintering. And I am really glad to announce you, we are one of the most unique laboratories in India with this modern equipments. Now, one of our senior PhD students will explain about compaction molding facility.
Hi, this is Anup Kumar Patel, a PhD student of BPCL group. My area of research interest is polymer CNT based biocomposite materials. In this work, we used to fabricate and characterize various type of polymer composites. This is the compaction molding technique, which is used to fabricate various type of pellets and seeds using different types of dyes. This dye is used to fabricate pellets, as well as these are the various dyes used to fabricate seeds. Now I am going to show the how dye is put into the machine for polymer fabrication. Now we have to put the dye with filled powder of required materials. This material may be metals, ceramics, polymers, and composites. We may set the required pressure and temperature. This machine is used to apply up to 40 megapascal pressure and about 350 degrees C temperature.
So far, we have learned about how to compress a powder into various shapes. Now, we will learn about how to do the introspection of these synthesized pellets by various techniques, which Rita will be introducing you about.
Hi, I'm Rita Maurya, a PhD scholar of BPCL group. So after sintering of compacted powder, we have to see the microstructural features evolve during the process. So before seeing the microstructure, we have to grind the sample, then final polish the sample to make it scratch free. This is the rotating wheel polishing machine for polishing the sample. Okay, now the sample is polished. Let's investigate the internal structure carefully. So, for seeing the microstructure, we have to etch the sample thermally or chemically to resolve the grain boundaries. This is the optical microscope to see the microstructure. So, here you can see. This is the microstructure of the processed sample. Here you can see the microstructure of the sintered pellet. Here you can see the different phases formed during the processing.
It's evident by now that our lab primarily focuses on biological materials, SOFC and HT ceramics. And for that, we have various instruments which measure the mechanical, electrical and tribological properties of the materials. Don't worry, tribology is not a word from another planet. Tribology is basically the science of friction when two bodies are in articulating motion. Wettability of material plays an important role in biological, tribological and thermal properties. So now we have Anil and Anup
who will be demonstrating about various techniques and instruments used for this.
This is a tribometer machine used to measure coefficient of friction between two materials, and it can be used in dry mode as well as wet mode. And this is the data obtained for 5000 cycles, and this shows the coefficient of friction versus number of cycles.
This is contact and goniometer, and this is the stand where we put the sample, and this is needle by which we used to put few micro drops of liquid medium in order to take the contact angle of the material, as contact angle play important role in biocompatibility as well as sliding and fitting wear performance of the material. We have STA 800 and STA 600 thermal analyzers used to analyze the melting point, degradation, thermal stability of the materials.
Hi, I am Bhima Shankar, student of this lab. I am working with high temperature furnaces. This is the pellet. I am putting it into the furnace for sintering purpose.
We always have to think how we can improve the property of a material for a particular applications. So yes, you are right, it's surface. We have to play with the surface. So let's start the game, which includes the electrodeposition and chemical vapor deposition.
I am Shikha. I am working on this instrument, which is an electrodeposition setup potentiostat, for which we prepared an electrolytic cell which contains an anode and a cathode, and the electrolyte which is made of the salts of desired metal which we want to plate from the anode to the cathode. With the help of this instrument, we utilize the coatings of metallic from one substrate to the another substrate using the software PowerSuit, and with this software we optimize the parameters and obtain the coatings of metal as per their application.
Now we will see some practical models developed by Mr. Abdul Rahim Siddiqui, a research scholar of our group. It's a simple CVD approach.
I am Abdul Rahim Siddiqui, a PhD scholar in BPCL lab. I deposited superhydrophobic carbon nanofiber on various substrates like metal, ceramic, and some of the polymer. Now I will show you the CVD setup. In this CVD setup, we purge a volatile gas in this hot chamber which decomposes at particular temperature to form a final product which is superhydrophobic CNF. Now I will show you different superhydrophobic CNF coated substrate. These are the coated substrate including glass, ACF, that is activated carbon fabric, stainless steel mesh, steel, and metals, that is aluminium and magnesium. Now I will show you the wetting behavior of uncoated and coated mesh. When I will place a water which is dyed with the methyl orange on this uncoated substrate, now you can see it will penetrate through the mesh and spread all over the substrate. But when I place a water on the coated substrate, it gets rolled off from the substrate and it will maintain its spherical shape on the coated mesh. This is because of the superhydrophobic nature of the surface. Similar effect can be observed on the uncoated activated carbon fabric. You can see the water droplet is completely absorbed by the uncoated activated carbon fabric, whereas the coated ACF substrate shows the excellent repulsion of the water droplet. This type of coated substrate has the number of application like oil water separation, antibacterial, corrosion resistant, etc. Now I will going to show you a very small demo of oil water separation. This is kerosene oil and this is water dyed with the methyl orange. And this is the mixture of the oil and water, 5 ml each. So I will pour this oil water mixture on this coated mesh. You can see, due to the super oleophilic nature, oil get spread on the surface and finally penetrated through the mesh. Whereas the water droplets is remaining on the coated mesh. Now I will show you the separated oil. You can clearly see this separated oil does not contain any trace amount of water.
So far we have discussed so many technical things.
Water is a very beautiful gift of nature, but it is regularly contaminating by the pollutants. The major pollutants are the oil and also the organic waste from the industries. So this type of surfaces can be used to control all these pollutants from the water. And it is very good scope for the future scientists and researchers. Thank you.
Hi, welcome to the Cell Culture Facility, which has been sponsored by Department of Biotechnology. So why do we need this facility? Because we deal with biomaterials. What are biomaterials? These are the materials which are designed to replace a damaged or a diseased body part. For dealing with biomaterials, we must know the essentials of biocompatibility. Before implantation, we must ensure that the material should be compatible with the body tissues and the cells. So we do the cell culture experiments. These experiments are done in vitro, that is, outside an animal model. And the experiments which are done in an animal model, they are known as in vivo. So here what we do is we culture cells, different cells. The most common ones are L929, mouse fibroblast, SAOS2, human osteosarcoma cell lines, HFOB, human fetal osteoblast, and various others. For this, we must ensure highly sterilized conditions. That is, we should remove our footwears before entering the lab. Now, Anoop will give an introduction to the cell culture laboratory.
This is liquid nitrogen cylinder where cell lines are preserved at minus 196 degrees centigrade at cryo temperature. Before entering into cell culture lab, it must be ensured that airflow should be on and ultraviolet should be off, which is used in order to kill the bacteria and viruses in the lab. This is our working chamber known as air laminar flow, where the cell culture on biomaterial samples is performed, that is known as in vitro testing. These are the different mediums, those are used in cell cultures, and this is the petri dish known as 24 well plates, where we put the biomaterial samples and use in vitro testing. This is CO2 incubator used to incubate cells at parameters, that is temperature 37 degrees C and CO2 concentration 5%. This is microscope which is used to see the cell lines at different magnifications like 10x, 20x, 40x.
Till now, we have learned about cell culture, tribology, contact angle. So now, I welcome you to the bacteria culture lab. Why do we need to know the essentials of bacteria culture? Is because post-implantation, the growth of bacteria on the implant surface causes a major reason for the implant failure. How it takes place is the bacteria adheres on the biomaterial surface and it further proliferates and forms biofilms, which causes infections, leading to fatal infections and implant failure finally. So, in order to avoid this problem, we must ensure that our biomaterial should be incorporated with a particular bactericidal agent, for example, silver, zinc oxide, etc. So now, we in this lab deal with the two most commonly found bacteria, S. aureus and E. coli. This is the deep freezer where we keep the stock, where we preserve the stock of the various bacteria. This is the incubator. This is maintained at 37 degrees centigrade, the normal body temperature. These are the agar plates. This is the agar plate showing the bacterial colonies. The bacterial inoculum, which is used for the seeding on the implant surface. So this is the biosafety cabinet wherein we perform the bacteria culture experiments under highly sterilized conditions. This is the media used for bacteria culture, the most commonly found media, that is the Luria Burtoni broth. And we have some samples on which we do the seeding of the bacteria, that is we inoculate it with some bacterial suspension and we grow bacteria for 4 hours and then we keep it in the incubator, and the absorbance is read after 4 hours, or even the morphological characterization of the bacteria adhered on the material surface can be viewed by SEM analysis.
Hello, I am Alka Gupta, PhD scholar in this high temperature fuel cell lab and bioceramic lab. I am working on electrolyte ceramic material which is used as a electrolyte material for solid oxide fuel cell. For this, electrochemical impedance spectroscopy technique is used. This technique is used for materials like dielectric, electroceramic and other oxide materials to measure the electrical properties of material. This is the high temperature impedance analyzer setup. In this, we can hold our samples and make a high temperature, and as a function of temperature and frequency, we can measure the capacitance, resistance and admittance of the material. These parameters are used to measure the ionic conductivity of the material. This is the LCR, Hauke LCR setup, and the range of this setup is 5 Hz to 5 MHz, and AC impedance voltage fetched to this setup is 70 millivolts. When this output of this from this temperature furnace sample is connected to our analyzer, and now this analyzer is connected to the interfaces with the computer, and where we get the impedance plot and we can reuse for it as a ionic conductivity measurement. That's it. Thank you.
So far we have discussed so many technical things, but only some good research result or good publication will not give us sufficient happiness in our life. But a cup of coffee, some chilled out moments with our lab mate can give us sufficient happiness in our life. It's 4 o'clock in the evening, and the easiest, cheapest cafe coffee day is calling us for a party. Now we'll go for a party in the cafe coffee day of IIT Kanpur.